My name is Vikas, and today I will talk about how to analyze Java performance problem in Eclipse using a profiler. Today's session would be a beginner session, and it would be oriented towards Eclipse. A little bit about myself. I have over 22 years of IT experience. I'm currently working at IBM. I'm the project lead for PD since 2015. I'm a committer in JDT. My interests include Java performance, obviously, and my Twitter ID is _VikasChandra. Let's look at the agenda for today. So we'll look at Java performance and profilers. We'll look at different types of YorkKit profiling. We'll see how to get started with fixing problems. We'll look at memory management, some JVM parameters, and how to find memory waste, memory leaks, and memory oddities in YorkKit profiles. At the end, I will conclude, which would be basically my experience working in Java performance. Java performance is of major concern in the software industry. An application should run correctly, but it should also run fast enough. So there are two aspects to it. First is the time taken, and second is the memory consumed. And both of them are dependent, as you will see. And the sum of the symptoms of bad performance is sluggish API application, out of memory exception, and non-responsive UI. What do you do when you get a performance problem? So do you just look at the suspicious code and try to fix it, or do you use a profiler? So it should be easy to understand that why the second option is better. Looking at suspicious code and fixing it is more like trying to hit in the dark, more misses than hits. And using a profiler, people who have used profiler will know that many times the bottleneck function is something else that we initially suspected it to be. Profiler also gives you a lot of data from where you can filter out what you want to fix. There are many profilers out there for Java application. JProfiler is one of them, which has interface for managing system performance, thread performance, and also managing memory leaks. JVM monitors CPU. It also monitors thread and memory usage. Java Visual VM is from Oracle, and it gives you detailed information about Java application. MAT is your memory analyzer tool, which is based on Eclipse, and it is a heap analyzer that will give you memory leaks and memory consumption. And today, primarily, we will use YorkKit, which would you do smart performance analysis, and a little bit of memory analysis also you can do on that. So in YorkKit, the first thing to do would be a CPU profiling. So I generally would recommend that you do sampling, tracing, and call counting profiling for the problematic scenario. All the three should be done together because you can then cross-reference. So a little bit of difference between all of them. Sampling is very good in accuracy for long methods, especially. Tracing is not that good for accuracy time-wise, but it has method call counting, and call counting just has call counts in the snapshot. So better to have all the three, because later on you need to cross-reference. This is the sampling hotspot area where you can see after the CPU profiling. So when you do a sampling profiling, you would probably want to go to the hotspots first, where you would look at methods that make the biggest CPU time. So I will not worry too much about native calls like Windows call or something like that. I will look at areas that are in my code. For example, if I'm in PD, I would be interested in PD. And you can go inside a function and see the calls, which that function calls which all function. That's Control M. And which all functions call this particular function would be Control Shift M. So as I said, I generally look at PD. So I would filter out based on PD and target the top 10 sampling time taken in that area. Tracing is another type of CPU profiling where you also get the method count, as you can see on the right-hand side. But you should not rely too much on the time information here, because it is slightly not that accurate. So you have to go back to the sampling and see the time, and for whichever method call, the time is high, look at the call count. And if some of the call looks suspiciously high, then you have to look at that particular area. Also, it is very important to look at get methods. And if you see that the same calculation is repeated again and again, you probably want to put that in a field or cache or do something about it in that get method. So many times you can probably improve there as well. So I will tell you about one experience that scenario that I had. So import breakpoint was taking close to 12 seconds. So on the top is the sampling, on the below is the tracing. In sampling, I got 16 seconds and I figured out that there were 13 calls to create EST, wherein it had the only one particular class breakpoint. So ideally there should have been only one count to this. So I tried to fix that code by storing that compilation unit in the class and based on certain condition reusing it. So it cannot be reused in all condition, but on some condition I reuse the compilation unit. And after that, when I do a sampling here, you can see it's 1.6 second, but in reality it's close to 1 second. And here the calls, create AST calls went to just to one. So tracing plus sampling is a good combination where you can try to fix few things. This is another example. This one is from API tools where get contents was taking a lot of time. So I figured out that for the same file, it was getting the input stream and getting byte stream for the same particular file. So for this, I stored that particular bytes in the class as a field, and that solved the scenario. But that will not solve if the file has changed and if you are using the old content. So in that scenario, the caching will not help. But in this scenario, I figured out when the file used to change, then the class object used to change. So this was safe enough. And this saved more than 10 to 15% of API analysis time. So are exceptions good? So exceptions, according to me, you should be used only for literal exceptions when you actually have exceptions and not as a code flow. For code flow, we have return and other constructs for code flow. Here, I would like to demo one scenario. Let's go into this particular exception test class. We have one method without exception, and I'm doing some random things out here, and this will never happen, but this calculation will happen all the time to make it equal to this particular thing where I'm doing the same thing and some calculation which will be true many times, and we will run that without exception and with exception. Let me run this particular scenario. Control F11, run. Without exceptions, we took 32 milliseconds, and with exceptions, close to 2 seconds. So my claim is that you should avoid exceptions unless when it is there is an exception. Now, how does it fit into the YorKit YorKit? So we in the sampling snapshot, we have the exception tab out here, and you can see a list of all the exceptions. So you can click on count to get the most number of exceptions first. And when you click it on the bottom, you can have a calculate path, which will give you the stack trace. Clearly 55,000 times exception does not look correct here. There could be, it could be used as a code flow, and you should go and look at all the such scenarios. Also, there is an inspection tab in YorKit. As you can see here, the right here, there is an inspection tab, and that has some of the easy problems that you can fix. For example, low hanging fruits, you can call it, because files not closed, files open but not used, threads created not started, some socket problems, some database problem, and things like that. So you can run one at a time or run all. I generally run all, and whichever for instance you get this issue, you click it on the right hand side, you will see this, and here you can get the stack trace from that, but from where this is happening. So the summary so far is we should try to look at the hotspots for a sampling snapshot, and we should look at when the method call is high and time in sampling is significant. look for get functions and investigate if caching helps, and eliminate exceptions as a code, as a control. So if it's used as a control flow, then you should avoid it. Inspection issue, you should use, you should look at it, and those are simple ones, and you can get started with that. One thing in Eclipse that we have seen, that many times we write a UI thread without thinking. If the element, if the things to be run can be run in non-UI thread, you should use a normal job, and you should avoid running UI jobs. But if in a normal job, if you are using UI element, you will get exceptions. So you have to make sure that you should use a normal job if it has a non-UI things. So I've seen many such improvements where jobs could be run non-UI, and it was run in UI, and then you in a normal job, then there was good user experience because the UI was not waiting, and in the background, that particular thing happened. Now let's talk something about memory management in Java. So whenever you write a line of Java code, for example, you write string as is equal to new string something, or call a function, memory is allocated by the JVM. So there are memories allocated at the stack or in the heap space. Stack generally contains the local variables and the reference variables. And if this is full, you see Java throwing java.lang. Stack overflow error. We generally see in recursive call, or rather badly written recursive calls. And heap, in heap space, JVM allocates the memory for Java objects dynamically, and also of JRE classes. So if that is full, then we get out of memory error. Garbage collection is the process of freeing space in the heap. So there are referenced objects and non-referenced objects. For non-referenced object, garbage collection can happen over time. But for reference object, garbage collector cannot collect those objects. So once I was working on a JUnits, and I figured out that it took 10 minutes to complete that JUnit. So I then looked at it, and I found that XMX value was 512M. And when I sort of went and corrected to 2048, then it ran in half the time. So it could also be a symptom of memory leak, but you have to look what is the requirement of that particular application. Is it really requiring more than 512MB? In that case, you should increase the XMX to 2048 or whatever is the suiting your application. So changing this depending on your application and your device sometimes helps to make things faster. JVM has many types of garbage collector. Use serial garbage collector is when the garbage collector freezes the application while it is doing its work. Parallel GC manages heap space via multiple threads, and you can even pass the number of threads as parameter, which is use parallel GC threads. Use concurrent mark sweep GC is a deprecated garbage collector, so let's skip that. And G1GC is a garbage collector designed for application running on multiprocessor machines with large memory space. So that's a default from Java 9 onwards. And JET garbage collector was started as experimental garbage collector in Java 11. And it is more for the applications that require low latency, like less close to 10 milliseconds. So if the requirement is that your application should not even stop for 10 milliseconds, you should use JETGC. But if you have a small data set or application can be run in a single processor, no pause requirements, then use serial GC. And if peak performance is required and pause of 1 second is acceptable, then parallel GC is a good GC. And the default is anyway G1 GC when the response time is more important and GC pauses is less than 1 second. JVM also does a lot of other optimization. Use string deduplication is one of them. When there are multiple string of the same value in your application, then JVM optimization. If you use this particular JVM parameter, because internally, then it will store it as a global array and it optimizes by that particular way. In your kit, this is achieved using memory snapshot. So whenever you have done with the the actions that cause memory leak or high memory in your application. You should run this capture memory snapshot, and then you should look at Objects Explorer first. So you will get a list of classes which have the highest retained size and shallow size. And below, you can see calculate paths. If you click that particular path, it will give you a stack trace just like this. So what's the difference between shallow size and retained size? Memory allocated to store just the object is the shallow size. So, but the retained size is shallow size of the object, but the plus shallow size of all the direct and indirect references, meaning which is only accessible from this particular object. So when you free up your shallow size, a garbage collector can actually free up the retained size. So retained size is more important. So you should sort based on retained size and based on the stack trace, tackle if they are actually cached things that are required for your system, or whether you can throw away those memory without hurting the system's result. There is a memory inspection tab in memory snapshot. So that gives you a lot of things like memory waste, possible leaks, other memory oddities, and we will let's look at one by one. Duplicate string, as the name says, gives you duplicates. And while you can, like the other one, you can run all at a time or one by one. And here you would have options whether you want to have two duplicates or 10 duplicates, then only you can have, or 10,000 bytes or 100,000 bytes. Or you can sort based on waste and duplicates, and you can look filter based on your area where you're working and then look into it. So your objective should be minimize the memory waste. So it's easily available in your kit. Null fields is another thing that this memory inspection tab of memory snapshots gives you. For example, here it's giving us F generic signature is 93% is null. So what it means is out of 100 objects, 93 of the objects have F generic signature as null. Let's look at this F generic signature, where it is. So it's an API member, and clicking F4 here will give you a type hierarchy. And you can see that is extended from API field, API method, and API type. And clearly, F generic signature has nothing to do with API fields, at least. So probably this could have resided in method and type, or you could have another kind of abstraction, maybe a generic type or whatever. So you can have another abstraction to make sure that the it is not null most of the time. Duplicate objects is when the same object is created multiple times. So let's look at this particular scenario. And at the bottom, you can see where it is coming from. It's coming from scanner char object, char array underscore length. Similar here also, you can see where it is coming from. So let's look at this particular thing. So here it has, you see all the references, and you will figure out key. That it is the same same thing every single time. So can we do something about it? Can we you make it static? Can we make it into another class or object and use the same instance in multiple instances of scanner? So by those methods, you can probably fix this particular problem. So you have to evaluate all the scenarios that is possible before coming up with a solution. If you come up with a solution wherein you just remove this, and in one scenario it should be different, then you are in for trouble. Sparse primitive array is when you have array of length 100 and you are using the first three only. So then your kit will say that 97% of your array is unused all the time. So you should contemplate another data structure. So the memory snapshot of your kit gives you this also very easily. Now, memory leak. So if there is a memory leak, then slowly the system performance will go down, and when the resource are totally gone, then you would get out of memory errors. So memory snapshot inspection tab also gives you where the internal class in anonymous internal class has the reference to the outer class, which is one of the reasons for memory leak. So let's look at this particular scenario here. So here there is a class which adds string into a string list, and there is some memory internally here. And when you run this, the garbage collector cannot collect the this one after the next iteration because it is referenced from the anonymous inner class. So let's run this and see what happens. So as you can see, the heap size is increasing, and only a matter of time before we would get out of memory exception. And the way to fix it would be to convert this to a normal thing. So if I just do this, and now if I run it, okay. Semicolon. So now it is able to run without any problem. Now let's look at some of the other memory oddities. So when YorkKit can also find out if you have integer variable here, and it has, for all the instances, it could have stored in a byte data structure. So for example, let's look at this particular example here. And here this could have been stored in byte, and this obviously will improve the memory by a little, and you have to be careful that in some scenarios it does not go out of byte after you do it, so you have to understand the code better. And also YorkKit gives you a bad hash code hash map distribution. So let's look at one particular demo here. So we have employee, we are adding the same thing again. It has some data here, and we have not put any hash code. It's just to print your hash code number. And let's run this particular application. You are getting different hash code for the same element, and a matter of time when you will get a out of memory error. So assuming you had based on the name, assuming the name is unique here, and if you have run this particular application, you could have got, everything would have been fine because the hash code returned is of the same value, and that means everything is okay. Also here, if you had not given this equals, and if you had probably relied on super SQL, and return. So again, here, although the hash code is fine, but it could lead to memory issues because it will just check the reference, and every time it's created, it's a new reference. So it does not compare that employees to the employee, assuming the name is unique. So you can see these kind of problems you can easily get. So let's get to one other demo, which is string builders versus string concatenation. So I have this particular demo, and here for multiple concatenation, I use string builders versus string. And here a lot of objects will be created, and my claim is this will be slower than this one. So string builder is faster. So let's try this one. So what I want to say is that we in Eclipse also have a performance tab. So here you can see string builder took only 16 milliseconds, wherein this took 7 seconds. So we have a performance cleanup tab, which I will quickly show you. And that has a performance tab, which can fix these kind of things. With that, let's conclude this session. Use a profiler. Don't get overwhelmed by a lot of data. Use proportionate effort. Just double check without a profiler. optimize if a function is used many times, eliminate exceptions, use the various memory and CPU inspection tab issues which I've discussed in this meeting. And with that, you will have a more better performing applications. So these are the references I took. Go through the YorkKit documentation. It's very good. And thank you very much for attending this session. And please do remember to evaluate the session. Hi, welcome to the Q&A session. So I have many questions coming. The first question is, can I profile an Eclipse plugin just like a normal Java application using YorkKit? So when you profile an operation, if there are code executing from that plugin, that would get profiled. But if you just want to do a static analysis, maybe there are other applications that just does a static application. So I'm not sure what this means, but if there is a operation which uses code from a plugin, that would be profiled once you do that particular, you add YorkKit to that particular scenario. Let's go to the second question. Has YorkKit any precondition required for Java like SAP, JVM profile? So YorkKit keeps on coming with all the latest features, and every 6 months or something they have different releases, and they support the latest version. So I think they are supporting, means they support very soon to the Java release. So once the Java is released, they try to support it. So I don't see a lot of delay from YorkKit supporting the latest Java version. So that's what my experience is. The third question is, let me have this third question. How do you improve code that is executed on the UI thread as a decorator, but takes significant time to do stuff that does not need to run in UI, resolving class path, other JT operations things? The UI operation usually needs the result of non-UI code and might not be able to make UI thread free for the UI tasks in the meantime. So in the job, you can add a change listener, and then you can override the done function. So when the job is completed, then in the done function, you can do such things. So there are other ways to do it. So you will get that notification when the job is done, and when it is totally done, the non-UI stuff, you can probably use the result of that in your done segment. Let me look at the fourth question here. I used YorkKit years ago. It had a real hard time with lambdas and method references. Did it get better? So I have used YorkKit, but I've not had a too much of bottlenecks in lambda methods. So I didn't check. So at this point of time, I don't have this answer. But most of the lambda support, even in Eclipse, is getting better with time. So I hope they have got better. Okay, so let's go to the next question. YorkKit is a commercial product. How does it compare to free Java profilers? I think there are other profiles like Matt, and I've used that as well. And I think YorkKit is one of the leading profilers, but there are other good profilers as also. So it's definitely YorkKit is better than many of them. So I would like that at least start using anywhere. You can start with the free profilers or even YorkKit. So that depends on your need or something like that. So there are no further questions. So I have a couple of points to make. So the objective of this talk was to generate interest in Java profiling and Java performance issues, especially in Eclipse, because most of the time in our many of the forums, we see that the cons of Eclipse is slightly slow. And also we in Bugzilla, if you log in bugs with performance tag, somebody would probably have a look. So I'll recommend everyone to do that. And if you like numbers, you will like profiling very much. So Thanks for listening to my talk and have a nice day.